Okay, so I think I've covered some of the basics of the scenario and the game in question, and since I don't have any scripted pages for any of my videos, I think that they are a bit disjointed and maybe the information is not all that helpful, but I think that it would be best to proceed with taking real turns and showing what this game has to offer instead of me going around the map and showing you some theoretical stuff and talking about them. So we will begin with turn number one of the Field Commander Alexander Granicus campaign, and if we take a look at the sequence of play, it says preparations, advance, turn, counter. So we move, let me just move this to the side here so I have some additional space for my arms. We move the campaign turn counter down once, and we get to the next step, which is refit, and that would allow us to refit our army if they had been damaged, but since this is turn one, our entire army is fit at this particular moment. So we move on to the next order here of sequence of play, and it says enemy orders. Remember this is to see what the three strongholds would do on this turn, and this depends on distance to Alexander's army, which is up here at Macedon. So we roll a d6 for all of these strongholds, beginning with Sardis up here, and that's a 2. And then we count the distance to Alexander, which is 1, 2, 3. These are two areas, Ilium and Sestus, so 3 and 4 to Alexander. So 4 plus 2 is a 6, and the chart says 6 to 7, one garrison. So that means bolster the enemy force by one random unit. So we draw from the enemy top, and I will look away while doing this. And here we go. We draw one regular infantry unit, which bolsters the enemy forces at Sardis. And then we do the same for Harkarnassus down here. And that's a 4. We count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So that's 6 plus 4, and that's 10 plus, so do nothing. And then the last stronghold, which is at Lycia. And that's 1. So let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Plus 1 is 7, and that's the same as the first stronghold. Let's draw one additional force, and I will again look away while doing this. Let's take this one. And that's another regular infantry. So Lycia now has a force of a light cavalry and one infantry unit. Then we get to the next step, which is enemy operations, and we get to draw one of these operation tokens and see what it's a bit fiddly. I'll stop this video. Okay, so I've fixed the stack now. This is the danger you have to face while recording. But here is our enemy operation. It says one force, which means add one additional unit here to the enemy operation counter, which are enemy reinforcements that would be coming in once we draw the go token. Now we can pay two gold to actually cancel this, but I don't think we will be doing this since one force is not that dangerous, and this is the beginning of the game. We only have 10 gold, and we need that gold to be able to move around the map. So I will let them have an additional force for reinforcements. I will draw one randomly, and that is a chariot. So they have a chariot. Let me see. There you go. They have an additional unit in the form of a chariot down here. And we are now done with the enemy part of the turn, and we get to the conquest part, which is our part of the turn. And this part you can actually repeat as many times as you want. So this is a scouting role, and then you get to choose to move, and then you can battle, and then you can do it all over again, or you can stop and you can gain gold and spend your gold. So we will do a scouting roll to begin with. So let's see. That's a 5. And I've already talked about this. Depending on what you roll, you either get to pay gold or you suffer hits. But if you roll equal to the number of units you have in your army, the coast is clear and you get to move without any penalties. So we move from Macedon down here to Caronea and invade the southern Greeks, and I will now move the southern Greek army to the battlefield. Okay, so now I have moved the southern Greek forces to the battlefield, and I have ordered them in the order of initiative. As you can see, they have two units that have initiative of 1, which is their leader and their phalanx. So this is the order that they will be attacking. But before we do that, we have to go through the battle plan, drawing of the battle plan before combat. And that step you can see down here at the battle sequence. We have step 1 is drawing enemy battle plans. Step 2 is our own battle plans. And step 3, we resolve the combat. For the enemy battle plans, they actually get to draw one battle plan for each unit they have in their army. So that would be 4 in this case. But we do have our advisor, which is Parmenion, and he lowers that value by 3. So the enemy only get to draw one battle plan. And the battle plans are up here in this cup here. So I will draw one now randomly. I will look away as to not to cheat, and be this one. Okay, so that says, we can place it up here, that says raid, pre-battle. We get to roll a d6, and on a roll of 1 to 2 we have to pay 2 gold, and a roll of 3 to 6 we have to pay 1 gold. So let's do that before we do anything else. Let's roll a d6. That's a 4. By the way, this dice is terrible. As you can see, it looks damaged, or it looks like it's fairly bad quality. And this is the dice that comes with the game, but I don't know. I like it still. So we rolled a 4, which means we have to pay 1 gold. We have 10 gold to start with, and we will pay one of these. If we flip the token to the other side, we see that that's an 8, and then we just add we add a 1, so we have 9 gold now. Okay, so for our own battle plans, we don't get to draw one for each unit in our army. We actually get to draw equal to Alexander's battle value, and his value is 1, so we would only get to draw one battle plan for this particular battle. But since this is a special battle, and the campaign rules, under the campaign rules here, it says King Philip II, which is Alexander's father, it says Alexander gets 3 extra battle plans at the Battle of Caronea. This is the that's the battle we are at right now. You keep the Alexander army token to indicate where on the map you are currently. So we get to draw 3 additional battle plans, and that would mean 4 battle plans for our own army. And for us, we don't actually have to draw them randomly. We can choose battle plans, and these are the different battle plans that we have to choose from. The fate one is kind of special. It depends on number of temples you have currently on the map. So if you had built a few temples, you would get extra rerolls that you can use during the battle. The next one is charge. It says one cavalry doesn't wait. Like we talked about, cavalry units can only attack every other turn. So if we buy this battle plan, we could put it with our cavalry and it will get to attack two times in a row. You can buy this battle plan up to six times. Some of these you can only have one of, but two of them, I think, two of them you can actually buy up to six times. So the next one is lead, which means Alexander gets plus one each turn. And this will be the first one I will be getting. So we get to choose four of these. And I will take lead, place it below Alexander here. And now Alexander's battle value is actually two and a superscript of one, which means on a roll of two, he will do one hit. On a roll of one, he will actually do two hits. So that means that Alexander is a bit stronger now. Then we have the next battle plan, which is rally. Stop one hit. That basically means that you get to cancel one hit. And I will also be buying this battle plan. And I will just place it below my army here to indicate that this is my battle plan. Okay, so the next battle plan is flank. And this says either one cavalry or infantry unit scores plus one hit. So they do an additional hit on their successful combat roll. And cavalries are all mounted units. Infantries are only these units that say in on them. So these are only infantries. The phalanxes are not considered to be infantries. They are a special kind of unit. But I will be buying this as well, or taking this battle plan, and I will place it underneath my cavalry and infantry units to indicate that I can use this if I score a successful hit. Then we have regroup, which would allow us to regain a unit if it had been destroyed during combat. The next one is envelop, which says inflict hits equal to force advantage. That means you take the number of units you have in your army and you subtract the number of units the enemy has and you deal that many hits. So in this case that would just be one hit, but if we manage to destroy one or two of enemy units and still have our full army at our disposal, that would mean that we would do two or three hits. So I will actually pick the envelop as well. And I will just place it below here to kind of remind me that we have this battle plan. And the last one is sacrifice. That means treat the attack as a one, then destroy that unit. So, for instance, if we were to play that on our archer, they will do one damage, and then they would be destroyed. Okay, so these are our battle plans. These are the four that we get for free. And you can actually get extra battle plans, but you have to pay gold for them. Each extra battle plan costs one additional gold. This can be pretty useful in some situations, and I think actually that I will be doing this. I will not be getting one of the, or I might be getting the charge. I was thinking of getting an additional flank here so that we can quickly finish off the enemy if we score hits, but it actually might be useful to have this charge so that our cavalry can attack. So I think I will buy this as well. If you have all of the other battle plans, you can only buy the flank or the charge. Those are the only ones that you can actually have multiples of. But I will be getting the charge here and we will pay one additional gold for that battle plan. Okay, so now we are ready to begin our combat, and the way the combat roles work in this game, all of these units that are kind of in the same tier, they attack simultaneously. So all units with initiative of 3, so that would be the Sacred Band and our companion Heavy Cavalry, they would attack simultaneously. You can either roll multiple dice to indicate this. I roll green dice for enemy and white dice for myself, or you can just roll one die and keep rolling until all the units in one tier have attacked. Okay, so now we are ready to begin our combat. I did forget one thing here. These pre-combat battle plans, they are used up before combat, and then you just simply return them to the enemy battle plan cup. Since they only affect pre-combat, they do not have any additional effects on the rest of the battle. But I think that this actually looks like a battle that's heavily in our favor. We have 5 battle plans, and we have a force advantage from the get-go. But let us start rolling here, and I will take one die for me and one for the enemy. And we start off with the archers, our archers, which have initiative value of 5. So they attack first, and they hit on a roll of 1 or 2. So we roll for the archers, and that's actually a 1, so that's 1 hit. And like I said, we get to choose where we allocate these hits. We cannot choose the enemy leader. Only Alexander can damage the enemy leader. So we have to choose one of the others. And I think that the enemy phalanx is actually, it's actually the most dangerous unit. But if we pick the Sacred Band infantry unit, we will also reduce its initiative value, which means that it would move down a step, and our heavy cavalry can actually get to attack alone without the enemy getting to roll here. So if we are lucky with our heavy cavalry, we could do 3 hits and basically destroy the Sacred Band and the phalanx. So I think I will be doing this. I will allocate 1 hit on the Sacred Band, and as you can see, its initiative value went down to 2, so now it's down 1 tier further along. It's damaged, and the troops in this unit are have suffered some wounds, and they are a bit slower. So we then move on to our heavy cavalry, which is the next unit to attack, and we roll a die, and let's hope for a 4 or less here. And that's a 6, so that's a miss. Now the heavy cavalry is spent, and you can indicate this by either placing something on it or just turning it a bit around to show that it's spent. It cannot attack. You can actually flip it like this, exhaust it, so to speak. And they can't attack next turn. But if we use our charge, we could attack next turn as well. So we will see if we would want to do that. So we move on here. And the next units to attack are our infantry, the enemy infantry, and the enemy Sacred Band infantry. And these have all battle values of 2. And they only do 1 hit. So you can actually roll for all of these involved. So we will take 2 enemy die and dice and 1 die for our infantry, and we will roll them simultaneously. This cuts down on the number of rolls you have to do. And our infantry misses, one of their infantry misses, but one of the enemy infantry actually hits. So now we have to allocate 1 hit on one of our guys. And I don't know which one is the correct pick here. I think the infantry unit is the correct pick. So we will allocate a hit to the infantry unit, which means it would move down to initiative value of 1, and it will still do damage on a roll of 1 or 2. Since this unit actually attacked this turn, even though it's moved further down the track, it cannot attack again. So it has an initiative value of 1, and this is the tier we will be using for the next attack, or the upcoming attack. It cannot be part of that attack. It has already attacked once this turn. And since the enemy units have different battle values and my phalanx is a bit special, I will be rolling separately for these units. So we start off with, we can start off with the enemy leader, which hits on a 1. And that's a 2, so that's a miss. Then we move on to the enemy phalanx, which hits on a 3. And that's a 3, so that's a hit. And since this is a phalanx unit, it gets to attack again. But now its battle value is reduced to 2. So let's see, now it hits on a 1 or a 2. It has already scored a hit. That's a 6, so that's a miss. So the enemy has done one additional hit this combat round. And we then move on to our own phalanx, which hits on a roll of 4 or less. And that's a 5, so that's a complete miss. And now we have to allocate hits. The enemy scored one hit against us, and we need to choose which of our forces would take that hit. And I'm not completely sure. I don't want to kill off the archers. Normally the archers are the worst unit, so you would actually want to kill them off now and then. But I don't think I want to do that just yet. So I think actually instead of taking a hit, I will actually use the rally battle plan, which stops one hit. So I will use this up and it will stop one hit, which is the hit the enemy scored. And you just put it back to the battle plan track or wherever you have your own battle plans. And it's now spent and we cannot use it again this combat. So we then move on to Alexander, which is the last unit that has to attack. And Alexander has a battle value of 1, but because we have chosen the lead battle plan, he gets plus 1 and a superscript of 1. So he hits on a 1 or a 2. On a 2 he does 1 hit, on a 1 he does 2 hits. So let's see, let's hope for the best. Let's hope for a 1 here. And that's a 6, so that's a complete miss. And that is the first round of combat. You could choose to retreat, but I think we will be carrying on here. So we go on with the battle and we start all over again. We start with our archers and they roll. And that's a 2, so that's another hit. That's great. The archers have done 2 hits so far. They are the only units that a unit that actually has done some damage this combat. And I will basically allocate the hit to the Sacred Band Infantry again. And this will destroy the Sacred Band Infantry because this is the second hit they would be taking. So you do not discard this. You actually put it up here. It says in the resupply area, and it says destroyed enemy forces. So you place the destroyed enemy force there, and if you choose to end your turn, you would get gold, depending on how many enemy forces you have destroyed here. So now we can come to an this is an interesting decision we have to make. Basically we can use our envelop battle plan to inflict 2 hits on the enemy forces, or we could hope for Alexander rolling really well and actually killing the enemy leader, which would net us additional 2 glory for this battle. But I think we will be taking the safe route here, and I will use the envelop to deal 2 hits to the enemy army, and I will kill their phalanx. So now the phalanx is destroyed, and we place it up here in the resupply area. Okay, and then I will use my charge battle plan as well, and that would allow my maybe I should have done that before, but whatever. I will use my charge battle plan and allow my heavy cavalry to attack again. So now it can roll to attack again, and it hits on a 4 or less. So let's hope for the best. That's a 5, so that's a complete miss again by the heavy cavalry. Now they are exhausted one more time, and this basically means that they cannot attack next turn. That's too bad, because they could have finished this battle off, but now we have to move on. And now the enemy infantry attacks, and it hits on a roll of 2 or less. That's a 4, so that's a miss. And then we get to the next tier, which is our infantry, our phalanx, and the enemy leader. So we roll for the enemy leader first. It attacks. That's a 4, so that's a miss. Then we roll for our infantry, and they hit on a 2 or less. That's a 2, so that's a hit. So we have scored one hit so far. And then we roll for the phalanx, which hits on a 4 or less. And that's a complete miss, but we did score one hit. So that hit will be allocated to the enemy infantry, which would move down a tier. Just like our infantry did when it got hurt. Then it's the next or the last unit attacking again, and this is Alexander, and he hits on a roll of 2 or less. That's a 4, so he misses. And we start all over again. We have our archer, it hits on a 2 or less. That's a 5, so that's a miss. And then our heavy cavalry cannot attack, so we just ready it for the next turn. And we move on to the big tier here at the initiative value of 1. We start off with the enemy leader, which hits on a 1. That's a 4, so he misses. Enemy infantry hits on a 2 or less, and he misses. And then our infantry, which hits on a 2 or less, and it hits. And that means that the last enemy unit is destroyed, and the enemy leader actually flees the battlefield. But you still get to gain gold for him, which is unfortunate. I kind of wanted Alexander to kill him and gain some additional glory. But that's okay, we only suffered one hit during this battle, so I say that it is a successful battle. Okay, so now we come to the aftermath of this battle, and I've already moved my battle plans back here. And we, to start off, we gain 2 glory for winning this battle. Sadly, no additional glory. And we would get 4 gold here, but we do not want to end our turn just yet, so we will not be getting that gold right now. The big decision here is, since this is a pivotal area, you get to decide to either govern or raise the area. If you govern the area, you gain 5 gold each turn. If you raise the area, you immediately gain 12 gold. So that is what I will be doing. I will raise this area to the ground. I'll teach the southern Greeks to oppose me, and I will immediately gain 12 gold, which means that we will be getting up to 20 gold here. And that's this marker here on the back side. So there you go. Now we have 20 gold for our campaign, and now we get to decide if we want to repeat the conquest step or if we want to end this turn. And I will repeat the conquest step. Well, you do get to roll the scouting roll before deciding, so I will roll a scouting roll to actually see what the danger would be moving back into Macedon here. So let's see, let's roll here. and that's a 1. Well, it's not that bad. Remember, if we roll less than our combined enemy combined number of enemy units, we have to pay gold. So this would mean that we have to pay 4 gold to be able to move into Macedon, since there is a shortage of food there apparently. And I will be doing this. I will pay 4 gold, going down to 16 gold. And yeah, it's on the back side of the 20 token is the 15. And then we gain 1 additional here, so we have 16 gold. And we would move into Macedon. Since this area actually contains a prophecy, we get to choose to either accept or shun the prophecy. And remember, these are quests for Alexander, for him to level up. And I will actually, you don't get to look at this prophecy. You have to decide beforehand if you want to accept or shun it. And I think I will accept it. Now, these can be dangerous. They can be quite hard to complete, and you might miss a turn by doing that, but I think it's worth it. I think I will accept this prophecy just to see what it is. And it is, okay, pray to the winds. That means that we have 2 turns to discard 5 gold, and we can do this whenever we want. So we could do this right now, if we wanted to, we could pay 5 gold and complete it. But I will place it here 2 turns from our turn marker to indicate that after this turn, if this prophecy is not fulfilled, we have to take 1 level off Alexander. Now, the game couples Alexander's levels glorifications, so he gains glory and he's glorified, and he the more glorifications he has, the better he is. But you can just call it levels if you want. That's a bit easier to grasp. Okay, so that was our conquest step once again. Now we get to choose if we want to end our turn or if we want to move on. And I say that we move on. Let's roll our scouting roll to see how dangerous it is to move into Cestus this time. That's a 3, so we have to pay 2 gold to be able to move into Cestus, and I will be doing this. We go down to 14 gold here. 4 there. And 10, so now we have 14 gold. And we move into Cestus. Remember, the rules for this map says that we can freely move between Cestus and Ilium, even though there is a canal between here. So let's continue on here. Let's roll the scouting roll for the next area. And that's a 5. That's excellent. That's exactly how many troops we have. So the coast is clear and we get to move into Ilium for free. That's really good. And now we get to choose again if we want to accept or shun this prophecy, which is now in Ilium. And since this first prophecy is actually quite easy, I am tempted by accepting, but that might actually be tempting fate, so I don't know. Yeah, let's do it, whatever. Let's see what's hiding underneath here. That is, make your own. It says, no advisors for 1 turn. And that's also 2 turns ahead. So we would place it next to the other quest that we have, or the other prophecy that we have drawn. Now, to complete this prophecy, you have to go through the entire turn without using an advisor. So we could not complete this right now, since we have already used Parmenion for enemy troops last turn. But we could stop here at Ilium and then attack the enemy army in Granicus next turn, which, and then choose not to use Parmenion. But that is pretty dangerous, actually. This army has 5 units, so that would mean that they would get to draw 5 battle plans, and that's quite deadly. I don't think I can do that. So I will do a scouting roll just to see how dangerous it would be for us to move into Granicus. Let's see here. That's a 2, so that would cost us 3 gold to move into Granicus. And this army is not that dangerous. Well, they are fairly tough to beat. But I think we can do this. So, yeah, I will pay 3 gold. 3 gold and move us into Granicus here. And I will actually attack Memnon's army, Memnon's Persian army here. So I will be back after I set the battlefield for this battle.